Hey, Bill Ethman here for Money Evolution. In this video, I'm going to be talking about the three phases of your retirement plan and the different things that you need to be thinking about and how you map out these three different phases and how do you best optimize and put all of that together. But real quick though, before I get into the content of today's video, if you're watching this and things are making sense for what we're saying here, if you'd like to learn more about what we do at Money Evolution, we've got some links down in the description below where you can learn about the Money Evolution plan, our comprehensive, detailed one-on-one financial plan. We also have our retirement time machine program that's more of a DIY experience, still helps you to put together a great plan for retirement, but it's more of a video and kind of a self-paced learning experience there. Again, links down in the description below for both of those. So the three phases of retirement, I've talked about this in other videos. I think I'm taking a little bit different approach here with it though, but one is going to be the pre-retirement phase. So that's basically, you know, for anybody that might be, you know, generally 5 years away from retirement, some of the stuff you could even start to think about, maybe 10 years out from retirement, never hurts to put together that plan. I think the further out in advance that you put the plan together, I think the better options you're going to have for kind of optimizing everything and, you know, really kind of making the most out of what your stuff is there. So the pre-retirement phase, then you've got what we call early retirement. We'll talk about what that means, but basically, I guess the way I define early retirement is before your income and expenses start to normalize there. We'll talk about that here in a second. And then what I call normal retirement, and actually on the fly here, I'm actually gonna add one more category in here too that I think we need to think about, and that's the RMD age, where your required minimum distributions kick in there. So I didn't actually have it on my note card, but we're adding it now on the fly. So the pre-retirement phase, again, so that's gonna be like 5 to 10 years before you retire. And one of the things that I think, a couple things you should be doing there. Number one though, is you should be thinking, especially as you get close to retirement, you know, what is your withdrawal strategy and reduce risk, okay, of the portfolio. You want to be thinking about, hey, for 25 or 35, 40 years, whatever, you've been in the accumulation phase, but as you get a little bit closer, you may need to start withdrawing some money. So you need to have an idea of what those withdrawals look like, how much you're going to need each year, but then start to de-risk some of that, or at least have some money available so you're not having to take money out of something that could be down in value because the market's down there. So reduce risk. The other thing that might be happening is your cash flow in those years may improve. And I think we see this, I think almost everybody sees some cash flow improving. So Harvard economist Harry Dent, he's done a lot of demographic economics and things like that, projections on different spending patterns and things like that. He actually says that people tend to spend the most money in their lifetime in their 40s. It has to do with you know, birth rates, when people have kids, when people trade up to the biggest house they'll ever own. And I was in that phase not too long ago where it seemed like I was just a walking ATM where, you know, my, you know, kids always needed something. There was, you know, prom and soccer and hockey and all kinds of things, you know, happening that was a negative on the cash flow. And then as they started to become more self-sufficient, my kids are out of college now, they're working full-time, so I've seen my cash flow go up dramatically. You may see, if you've got a mortgage or you're paying off a car, you may see your cash flow improve from that. And so understanding that positive cash flow improvement, very important, especially if you've done some projections and maybe you're starting to think, hey, maybe my retirement's not exactly where I'd like it to be. So with that cash flow improvement, maybe I want to save a little bit more money in this time. So you want to really understand that and know, you know, where and how much money you should be saving, what type of account you should be putting that money into. So that's the pre-retirement phase, but probably the most important one is going to be this one right here, is starting to think ahead and plan for those retirement withdrawals. We don't want to create our retirement withdrawal strategy on the day we retire. The early retirement, basically, I think for most people, this is going to be before age 67. So if you retire at age 67, or later, I would say you probably skip over this early retirement phase and you just go right to normal retirement. And the reason why early retirement needs some extra special consideration is because if you retire at 60, well, at 60, you're not even eligible for taking Social Security benefits at that time. Earliest would be age 62. And for most people, it's probably going to make sense for them to wait until their full retirement age. For most people probably watching is 67. And so if you retire at 60, you'll have some bigger gaps, and almost everybody has bigger gaps in our plans as we do them for clients there, but you need to understand that. And so the way I really look at this early retirement is I look at that as funding early retirement needs to be completely different than funding your normal retirement. So for example, let me just get a really easy number here because my math works really well. So let's say that you determine that once your Social Security kicks in, and you've got if you got a pension or whatever, all those normal sources of income. Let's say that you still need $40,000 from your portfolio at your normal retirement age, at age 67. If you need $40,000, the quick math of that is if we use the 4% rule, which a lot of people have talked about, I've talked about here, is what they call a withdrawal rate where you have a pretty good chance the money's going to last you for the rest of your lifetime. That would tell us that you would need to have $1 million in your portfolio at your normal retirement age. And if you go through and say, okay, well, hey, I've got some random cash flows, I'm still paying off a mortgage for a couple of years, and you know, if I retire at 60, let's just say that I need, make the math easy again, $100,000 per year in those early retirement years. Maybe it's not quite, maybe it's, you know, a little bit higher in some years, a little bit lower, but we need $700,000. I would come into it and say, we got to fund the $700,000 independently of what we think we're going to need to have at that normal retirement age there. And so $1,700,000 is the target amount that I would say that we need to have for somebody's portfolio, given this situation. There's more to it than that. You know, we could put some growth rates in here and say, okay, well, you know, if I got 7 years to grow it, I don't maybe need to have $1 million in today's dollars. Maybe I can have a little bit less. But again, we always want to, I think my opinion anyway, is that we want to have a little bit of excess, a little bit of some buffers here so that we're not right on the edge and one market correction, you know, as we go into those first parts of retirement, it causes the whole thing to fall apart there. So we want to take that into consideration there. So this early retirement, again, we want to be thinking about what those cash flows are. Some other things that we need to think about here is healthcare. If we retire at age 60, we won't be eligible for Medicare for 5 more years. So we need to think about, are we going into the exchanges? Is there a COBRA option potentially there? What are those expenses? A great tool and resource for this is if you go to the Kaiser Family Foundation Healthcare Calculator, you go to that website, just put it into Google. And you go into that and you put in your zip code, your projected income, how many people are going to be covered, and it should give you a pretty good estimate of what the healthcare costs are going to be if you qualify for a subsidy or if that's something that's part of the plan. There are strategies to do that. We help clients with that all the time to structure their income in a way that can keep it low enough to qualify for one of those Affordable Care Act subsidies there. But you might have some higher healthcare there. Again, you may still be paying off a mortgage. You may still have kids that are in the house and they still have some expenses, and you know, that's maybe driving that gap up a little bit there. So be thinking about what that early retirement is. And again, I would say, you know, block that out. That money, because it's, again, fairly short term, my opinion of it is I think it should be much more on the conservative side so that, again, you're not having to liquidate something when it may be down in value. That normal retirement age, you know, a lot of times pensions may kick in at 65. You may get your Social Security benefits at 67. You also have to keep in mind your spouse's age, too. So you may be 67, you know, in 2025, but your spouse may not turn 67 until 2028. They're a few years younger. Sometimes there's bigger gaps there. When it starts to get too big of a gap, it starts to become a little bit too hard to really plan that out. If you've got more than, let's say, a 5 or 6 year gap, I would probably just use the older spouses as a as the normal retirement age, and then try to make that work that way. And there, you maybe create another column there if you had to there. But yeah, if there's an age difference between the spouses, you definitely want to be keeping that in mind, taking that into account there. And then the last one here too, that a lot of times people miss or they don't keep in mind, is the required minimum distribution age. And the reason why that's important is because that's when the IRS essentially mandates that you start taking withdrawals from your retirement accounts, whether you want to or not. That number, those ages changed a little bit here about a year ago, as they've changed a couple times in the last few years. But if you're born in 1960 or later, then age 75 is going to be that RMD age, but if you were born before 1960, it's going to be age 73. And so having a plan that incorporates that as well, because all of this is really going to kind of go into the strategy for creating that withdrawal plan that's going to be in a way that's going to take some of the risk out of it. So that, again, you're not having to liquidate when the market's maybe down, creating a buffer. We talk about bucket strategies. We'll do that again in some other videos here. But you want to be thinking about that. And there's also a lot that goes into the tax plan as well, too. So you know, okay, if I need this money, where's that money coming from? Is that going to be a capital gain? Is it going to be a distribution from a retirement account? Is that pushing me into a higher tax bracket? And then because we want to look at the RMDs, we want to always be comparing what is that future tax rate versus what is the tax rate today? And then we might do other strategies like Roth conversion strategies. If we're still working, we may change up where we contribute money. If we've got room in the bracket, maybe we do Roth contributions instead of traditional contributions. And if you're in a higher tax bracket, the IRS now mandates that you do some of those contributions in a Roth account, so you don't even have the option anymore. So anyway, hope that makes sense there. So the three phases of retirement. And again, if you want us to help you to map this out, we do it through some very high-end, very sophisticated software. We use the eMoney financial planning program there. The Money Evolution Plan is where we work with you one-on-one on that. That's where we can map out very specific scenarios, run Roth conversions and compare them to other scenarios in the plan, really get detailed on the retirement withdrawals. That's really great for a lot of people. But we also have a retirement time machine program as well, where we guide you to help you to build out your own e-money plan. There are some limitations to it versus what we do with the Money Evolution Plan. You don't have that advanced planning capability there, but you're still gonna get the cash flow mapping. You're still gonna get the reports. They're gonna show what those future tax years are for tax brackets down the road. And we walk through a lot of strategy in how to interpret the reports, something I think may be missing from other sort of DIY financial planning tools out there is not just how to get the information in, but how to understand the reports and what are the decisions you can make from it. So both of those are great programs. But again, we'll have some links down in the description below. If you'd like to check that out, go ahead and do that. And one last thing, we also have our Retirement Time Machine webinar too. So that's a free webinar. It's a little bit over an hour long. And if you haven't seen that already, it's a great thing, regardless of whether you're a better candidate for the Money Evolution Plan or the Retirement Time Machine. That'll kind of get you started on really the first four stages or steps of our seven-step financial retirement planning process there. So check out those links, and I look forward to seeing you in one of our future videos. Thanks.